In this class, we will see the educational implication of Buddhism. Educational implication means whatever the way of living and the teaching the Gautam Buddha has given. So, what is the implication of those things in the field of education? These things we will be discussing in this class. And when we talk about the Buddhist educational philosophy, okay, it means that the implication, usefulness of the philosophical shift proposed by the Siddhartha Gautam. Okay, that we will see. So, when we talk about the education as per the Buddhism, because when we talk about the educational implication of the Buddhism, then we have to start with the what is meant by the education as per the Buddhist philosophy. So, when we see the Buddhism, education is the true knowledge. We know that. The Buddhism emphasizes that education is the only truth, because we know that we have seen the Gautam Buddha when he came out of his palace, he saw the different sufferings and then he start thinking that what is the cause of those sufferings and how we can come out of those sufferings. So, as a mean of coming out of those sufferings, Buddhism believes that a knowledge is the only truth, which emancipates person, individual from the sorrow and the sufferings. And it helps in attaining the salvation. So, that is the main essence of education as per the Buddhism. Even when we talk Buddhism, as per the Buddhism, basic cause of sufferings, sorrow of an individual is ignorance. And we know that the Gautam Buddha says the fourth thing, that there is a suffering, there is a cause of a suffering, there is a solution of a suffering, and there is a way of coming out of our sufferings. So, education is a tool as per the Buddhism to come out of the sufferings and to attain the salvation. And in absence of the education or due to the ignorance, people used to suffer. So, this is the one of the important tool. And education must, so in this light, education must act as a tool, important tool, or as a education must have a role in removing the ignorance. So, if the education is able to come out of the ignorance, then that will be known as a true education. So, education is perceived in that manner as per the Buddhism. Now, we will try to define the function, because how it will function, because in the meaning, we are saying that education must act as a tool. So, what will be the functional aspect of the tool, that is the education, in removing the ignorance and in attaining the salvation? So, when we talk about that, the function, so the function of education as per the Buddhism is derived from the Ashtanga. We know that Gautam Buddha has proposed Ashtanga. He has proposed four noble truth and the eight folded path, which is known as the Ashtang. It is also known as the eight noble path. Means these are the path by which if you will follow, then you can come out of the sufferings and you can be enlightened. So when we talk about the function of education as per the Buddhism, it is as per the Ashtang. So the first function of education is that which is derived from the Samyak Drishti. Samyak Drishti, which is the right view. And the right view says that, so education must provide the opportunity for the individual, for the learner, for the children to identify the life and object in a real sense. Means after getting education, education must help learner, individual, to identify the meaning of life. What is the real meaning of life? What should be their duty towards the other living creature of the nature? What should be the duty towards the society? What should be the duty towards the different aspect of our life? So the Samyak Drishti says that there should be a right view, and education must function to develop the right view, to identify the object in the real sense. Then the next one is Samyak Sankalp, that is the right resolve. And here Buddhism assumes that by the education, individual will be adopting four noble truth in their life to have a right resolve in order to attain the nirvana. And for attaining the nirvana and for practicing the noble truth, Buddhism emphasize that individual should meditate. So an individual should be a meditator. So if there is a educated people, then the individual must be able to meditate for having a right resolve, that is a Samyak Sankalp, isn't it? Means your resolve should be right. Whatever you are resolving, that should be right. And education should function in developing. And what will be the right resolve? Right resolve as per the Buddhism is the non-violence, love towards the other, mercy, and coming out of the all type of desire, enmity and the jealousies. That is the right resolve. Okay, then when we see the third function of education as per the Buddhism is that Samyak Vak. Samyak Vak is the right speech, which is meant that expression of a right resolve. An individual can abide by the right speech and only speak a truth and which is a good. They should not speak which is a false, which should the person not speak which is creating a disturbance in the society or among the person. Okay, so that is the right walk. And how the right walk will be developed? Through the education, when the person will have a right resolve. And if the person is able to right resolve, then the person will have a right walk, that is the right speech. and that should be developed by the education among the individual. Then the fourth one is that samyak karmanta is the right action. You have right view, then the right resolve, then the right speech, then the right action. And here they say that beside, apart from the right view and the right resolve and the right speech, right action is a very essential to attain the nirvana. Because if you have right speech and right resolve and the right view, but your actions are not right, then it will also help the person to suffer. So in order to come out of the suffering, the right karmanta, that is the right action, is very much essential. And what are the right action? Right action is not harming anybody, not believing in the violence, not believing in the stealing, robbery, and speaking false. So that are the right action. Then the fifth function of education as per the Buddhism is the samyak ajivika, samyak livelihood. That is the another function of a Buddhism. Samyak ajivika is meant that after getting education, individual must be able to earn their livelihood. And livelihood in which sense? By following the right view, by following the right resolve, by following the right speech, and by following the right action. So a person must be able to get their livelihood by following the noble eightfolded path. So by following the Ashtanga, a person must be able to get their livelihood. So that is the important aspect of education that we will see. It's a critical analysis we will also do after seeing this function of education as per the Buddhism. So they say that after doing all those things, the person must be able to get their livelihood. And the samyak ajivika, that is a right livelihood, means getting your livelihood without harming anybody. Like that, when you must have seen during this time of a pandemic, when the people were suffering due to the corona, in the corona second wave, so some of the people were earning by harming anybody, by harming others. Like that, the black marketing of medicines, oxygen cylinder, and all those things. So that is also, you can say that they are earning their livelihood, but they are earning by harming other. So that is not admissible as per the Buddhism. Robbery, that is not admissible as per the Buddhism. Earning livelihood by stealing, by violence, by telling a false promise. So that is not admissible as per the Buddhism. And then the next function of education as per the Buddhism is samyak vyayam. Samyak vyayam is that right effort. So not only your livelihood and action should be right, your effort should also be right. And effort in the cause of a goodness, in the cause of a betterment of a society, that your effort should be right. And the effort is further defined in the Buddhism as that throwing away old evil thoughts or feeling. So coming out of a evil thought and a feeling, And if you are doing that, then your effort is arrived. Means the point of saying is that coming out of odd bad things. They even also say that preventing new thought, new evil thought or feelings to come. So if your mind is involved in ill ideas, evil thoughts, evil feeling, then coming out of that is also a incident of right effort. Even you should not engage your mind to a thought which is harmful for others. And even to continuously make an effort to act and to be good for the others in a thought and in an action. And they say that these things can be attained by the meditation. So if you are meditating, then you can attain these things. That's why the meditation is the one of the important tool in the Buddhism, which is emphasized for the education also. So individual who are getting education, they also meditate. If you are meditating, then only you can come out of the all bad things. So that is the one of the important feature of Buddhist education. Then the seventh function of education as per the Buddhism is Samyak Smriti, right mindfulness. Right mindfulness means you must have a good memory. You preserve the good memory, real memory, and all the good things you should preserve and keep, remember, and all the bad memories and the evil thought you should leave it. That is the Samyak Smriti, right mindfulness. And the last one is that Samyak Samadhi, which is the right concentration. So this is the last and the highest one, that is Samyak Samadhi, which means to inculcate the ability in the student to enter in the right concentration. So concentrate for the good things. You should think for the good things, which is better for the society, better for the individual, and which is acceptable as per the Buddhism. So when we see all the function of education as per the Buddhism, you will be clearly able to understand that the scope and a function of Buddhist education philosophy is wide, acceptable, and which is very much relevant in the today life. Because when we see the structure of life in the present time, we'll find that through the education, a person must be empowered to earn livelihood. And that is when you will see the different commission, committee, different report, even the National Education Policy 2020 and the earlier education policies also, you will find in every place the importance of livelihood and preparing the student for the livelihood is emphasized. And so many programs are also being run by the previous government and the present government, and hopefully it will be run by the future government also, because they identify that the value of livelihood in the education. That is, but more importantly, when we think deeper, it is also focused towards the moral development, earning livelihood by the right means, not harming other. And the third thing which is very much relevant here is the developing the emotional balances. When we talk about the right mindfulness, Samyak Drishti, Samyak View, it is also developing a emotional intelligence, that how emotionally you will be balanced in a difficult situation. And the recent research says that in spite of giving so much emphasis over the cognitive development, we must also emphasize on the emotional development. That's why nowadays emotional quotient have a more importance than the cognitive quotient, IQ and EQ. I'm not saying that the IQ is not now does not have a relevancy. It have and it is relevant, but the emotional intelligence EQ cannot be ignored, and that is talked by the Buddhist philosophy. That is the one of the very important point to point out, and that is also important point to learn from the Buddhism. You have to earn, you have to empower, but you have to earn all those things with the right thing. And to develop the goodness, you have to meditate. And in that way, it differs from the other atheist philosophy like a Chavaka and the Jainism. Jainism was more inclined toward the morality, and the Chavaka was more inclined toward the materialism. But it provides a balanced path, that is the mid path, Madhya Marga is the best mark, middle path is the best path, is emphasized in the Buddhism. Then we will come to the education as per the Buddhism, aim of education as per the Buddhism. We have seen the function. When we talk about the aim of education, first it emphasizes on the all-round development of the personality. How all-round development of the personality? Because when we see the function of education and the eightfolded path Ashtanga, it talks about the development of right view, samyak drishti, samyak karmanta, and the right resolve, right speech, right livelihood, right effort. Then it says that during the education, we must develop a person in a such a way that their emotional development should come up, their physical development should come up, because it is linked to the livelihood. And when we talk about the right action and right livelihood and right effort, it should be attained through the meditation. And for a meditation, a person must be physically fit. So it talks about the all-round development of the individual getting the education. Let it be the physical, let it be the mental, let it be the emotional. All-round development is emphasized in the Buddhism. Even when we talk about the aim of education, it emphasizes on the moral development also. Because when we talk about the right speech and the right resolve and the right view, it is a part of a moral development. When you are not indulged in the evil practices, bad things, non-violence, then what is this? This is a way to develop the moral character of the individual. Even the Buddhist education philosophy is aimed as a cultural development. Cultural development says that actually when we talk about the Buddhism, Buddhism has come in a situation where the Karma Kant and Brahmanism was suppressing the society. Means it was so powerful, Karma Kant. Anna, rituals, Karma Kant is the rituals. So ritual was so much emphasized in the Hinduism. So in response with that, the Buddhism emerged. And this is that in spite of doing, instead of doing a Karma Kant and a rituals, we should believe in the non-violence, doing the right thing, and thinking right. So that type of a culture should be developed and should be promoted. And because when we talk about the karmakand, it leads to a blind belief, fortunism, all those things it leads. So that should be avoided. Even when we talk about the aim of education, it also focused towards the social and vocational development. Because in the Ashtanga, it talks about the livelihood opportunity, and it also talks about the right resolve and right action. So when you are doing a right resolve and a right action, even the right effort, it is a way to establish a good social responsibility to others also. Because when you will do a right thing, when you will not indulge in the evil practices and the bad thing, you will not be doing the robbery and non-violence, all those things you will not be doing. So the people will start loving you. So it is also a way of developing the social and vocational. Okay, then it also talk at the end that personal development and attainment of a salvation. Personal development, because when you will do all the practices you will do, you have focused toward the social, vocational, cultural, moral and the all-round development, it will help you to live a very peaceful and very dignityful life. So you can live with a dignity. You can live life with the peace. Isn't it? So that is also focused in the Buddhism. And when you will have all those things, then you can attain the salvation. Anna, because you are free from all the ill practices. So that was the aim of education as per the Buddhism. Now we will see the curriculum. So at this juncture, I think there is a no difficulty in understanding that what will be the structure of curriculum as per the Buddhism. Because Buddhism is talking about all-round development. It is talking about the moral development, social development, cognitive development is that part also, even the emotional development and the opportunity for livelihood. So in the curriculum, both the part was balanced, the spiritual part and the worldly part. So for the spiritual part, there was a study of Vedic literatures. There was a study and the meditation practices. And for the worldly curriculum, there was an inclusion of subjects like Ayurveda, animal husbandry, physics, surgery, vocational subjects, music, handicraft, mathematics, all those things was included. So variety of subjects you can find in the Buddhist education system. And specifically when we talk, they promote five types of knowledge when we talk about the curriculum as per the Buddhism. The first knowledge was the verbal knowledge. Verbal knowledge was including the knowledge related to the language, literature, grammar, sentence structure like that, which is very essential for a communication. Then there was a handicraft knowledge. So it was including a skill and knowledge related for the livelihood and to support the industries. Industries is not like that at that time there was a big company, but industries is the way of earning your livelihood. Because in order to earn your livelihood, you need a skill. Okay, so that you will develop, produce something to earn your livelihood. So that was also included. Medicine knowledge, that was also included to treat the disease, the knowledge about the medicine, psychology, physiology, that was also emphasized, and the purposive knowledge, that is the knowledge of logic, reasoning, that was also emphasized, and in the last there was a spiritual knowledge. So the person can develop a samyak drishti, samyak vak, sarma karmanta, they can develop. So all the thing have been included in a balanced way when we talk about the Buddhist education system. Then we will see the methods of teaching. When we talk about the method of teaching, so you can easily identify with the aim, function and a curriculum as per the Buddhist education. Because it was including all the things and it was talking about the all-round development. And we have seen in the logic part also that it was focused towards the handicraft knowledge and the purposive knowledge, that is the logic. So obviously there was a variety of method. Suppose that when we are talking about the handicraft knowledge, so a skill development can be attained through a hands-on experience, hana, experimentation, involving yourself in the work, isn't it? So that was emphasized. When we talk about the medicine also, it was also emphasized here to have a hands-on experience to treat the people, hana, isn't it? So there was a variety of a method, like a lesson method, where the teacher was teaching the alphabets and numerals to the individuals to start the learning. There was a lecture method also, and lecture method was actually used at a higher education level. Okay, there was a debate and discussion method, so that will develop the logical reasoning and a logic that will develop. There was a question answer method, wherein the student were getting opportunity as a doubt clearance session. So whatever the doubt, whatever the difficulty they were having, that they can clear the question answer method. And this and even there was a method of self study, wherein the student were meditating and self studying the content. And there was a method of a seminar, in which the teacher divides the learner into two or more group, and they were debating over the topic to enrich their knowledge. So you can understand that the variety of method was there in the Buddhist philosophy. Even now we will see the concept of discipline in the Buddhism. What was the concept of a discipline in the Buddhism? So here, by the discipline, it is meant to follow the order and instructions of a Buddhist religion and Sangha, in which the complete devotion of each people, teacher and a follower is inherent. So whatever the teaching of a Buddha is there, this is there, they are supposed to follow in a true sense. That was a strict discipline for not only the student, even for the teacher and the followers. For all, that was a very strict discipline. And what was those things they are supposed to follow? That we can fetch from the four noble truth and the ashtanga, that is the eightfolded path. So that was supposed to followed by every individual in true sense. Okay, so that was, and when we talk about the concept of a student, in the Buddhism, in the Buddhism extends a very cordial and a very good relationship between the student and a teacher, and they was supposed to follow the eightfolded path that was promoted by Buddhism, that was proposed by the Buddhism. So here the student were fully dedicated in the teaching learning process and fully dedicated towards the educational institutes, and the teacher was in a true sense the spiritual and leader in the educational system, a spiritual leader with the skills. And as per the teacher, when we talk, the Buddhist philosophy outlines the types of a teacher, the characteristics of a teacher. They say that a teacher who claim to be pure, true and clean despite being on a contrary, that is the teacher. They should be pure, true and clean, and they should not indulge in any type of a contrary issue. Even they say that the teacher who have a pure livelihood despite any contrary, so they must earn their pure livelihood in spite of involving indulging in any contrary. And the teacher must have a good teaching, and they must involve the learner, inspire the learner in the right way. And they also prediction, they have a pure and a good prediction. They must be able to predict that what is required. Predict means not to forecast, means what is required to a student, and as per the requirement they must be able to respond. And the teacher must have a pure knowledge and a vision. Pure knowledge and a vision the teacher must have. So a teacher must be visionary. Teacher must have a good moral character. Teacher must earn their livelihood. And even side by side, the teacher, student must be also fully dedicated towards the teaching learning process, isn't it? So this was in very short, however there was a much discussion required when we talk about the Buddhism, but in short this was all about the Buddhism. I think now we can have a question answer session, because it's already, I am crossing the time limit. So if you have any question, you can ask